So, Father, anoint my lips of clay so that words of life will flow through, so that somebody would experience healing, change, peace, joy, hope, that somebody would begin to walk into their better. I pray today a word will come forth that someone will be motivated, be challenged to believe again, to hope again, to trust again. Father, we pray against every working of the enemy where this word is concerned. Let the word go forth with clarity and courage and boldness. In Jesus' name, amen. So we are continuing when the past remains present. When the past remains present. As Christians, all of our relationships should be seasoned with grace. As Christians, all of our relationships should be seasoned with grace. And I think one of the most affected areas during this pandemic was relationships. Yes, health and monies were affected, and careers, but one of the most affected areas, I believe, was the area of relationships. If you look around us, we are in a time, and I think relationships come under attack because most of our relationships oftentimes are not built on the right kind of foundation. And so we are in a time where the foundation of all things is under attack. And you know the Bible says, if the foundation be destroyed, what shall the righteous do? And Jesus must, by the way, be the foundation of all things. And all of the great experiences and the great things in life require a solid, healthy foundation. And who better to build on than Christ? After all, the Bible says he is the cornerstone. And so we ought to build on him. But society tells us that we don't need good foundations. We just need to come up. If you build a building without a solid foundation, it's only a matter of time before the building crumbles. And how many times have you seen it? Many people visit the heights of success only to fall. How many times have you seen it? Marriages, wonderful weddings, wonderful people even seemingly, but before too long, the marriages fall. How many times have you seen it? Great friendships, seemingly successful, but then they fall apart. And I think part of the problem is because we fail in establishing the basics, the foundation of things. Now, the Bible tells us about two major relationships. The relationship between God and man, or I guess the relationship between God and people. And then the Bible tells us about the relationship between people and people. Two major relationships the Bible teaches. The relationship between God and mankind and the relationship between people and people. And of course, I'm not talking about romantic relationships. I'm speaking of the privilege or the ability to enter into friendships, enter into relationships that are fun. Relationships that are fun. We need that, by the way. Not every relationship must always be about problems. Relationships must be exciting. There ought to be times in your life where you are actually excited to see somebody. Relationships ought to be enriching. And relationships ought to be comforting and warm and enjoyable. But if we're honest, we don't often experience those qualities in all our relationships, and if we do, not as often as we ought to. Every person need at least two relationships in your life that are warm, comforting, enjoyable, exciting, enriching, and fun. Now, sadly, Satan is doing, and he has done a great job at preventing many of us from being able to enjoy being in relationship with others. Some of us were destined to never hit, let me correct that. The enemy works to make sure that some of us never get to enjoy good relationships. The way you were raised, the brokenness in our homes, in our parents. And so the enemy has a field day in making sure, because he understands that if we can have good relationships, if we are united, if we're enjoying relationships, can you imagine what it would be like if Christians were actually enjoying being with other Christians? I mean, by the way, do you know that Christians ought to be the greatest, the bestest, I don't think that's a word, but the best friends? Like your work relationship, like people, you should be the most liked person at your job because you've got God. People should just like you. We should just naturally like each other. I'm not talking about love. But oftentimes not a lot of Christians are likable. Some of us are not very likable. And you know what's sad? Some of us don't care to be liked. It's a terrible thing. But God loves me, so if you don't like me, too bad. That's of the devil. And they'll know you are Christians by your love. Imagine a church. Imagine what Sunday would be like where we get together. This COVID thing is tough, because let's be honest. I mean we have a good, we have issues, but we have a good measure of liking amongst us. Turn me down a bit. And I know that, because you've tested my patience many a times pre-COVID. Won't you greet somebody? All right, take your seats now. But you like each other so much. After a while, I was just like, yo, God, just let them love. But you get what I'm saying. But I think, imagine what church would be like when we get together and it's all about friendships. We love God. That's ultimate friendship. And we love each other. So we long, you know, like you got to come to church. You love each other so much. You're going to come at 10:30 so you can talk and just be with each other. I want to be that. I want to be that. That's what I want our church to be like. Where people want to be in church, and not just because, oh, we've got problems or we got duty to fulfill, but we want to be there because we get to connect with friends, the ultimate friends and our earthly friends. You know, somebody sadly said to me one time, my dog is my only friend. I'm not going to talk about, I just remembered I should talk about people and their animals. But sometimes I see more affection going in that direction than going in the direction of somebody who can actually hug you back and listen to you and comfort you and warm you. And I'm not against animals and pets and all that stuff. But nothing beats a good human, healthy friendship. Some people don't even believe they could be friends with God. As a matter of fact, some people don't even believe in God anymore, much less to be his friend or accept his friendship. It's like the TV show called God Friended Me. It's kind of cool because every day God sends you a friend notification. Hey, want to be friends? The challenge is that our relationship with God and his word must always be priority if we're going to have healthy friendships. That's the foundation of life. That's the foundation of relationships. If you at the back can put something on the screen for me, John chapter 1. Let's do that quickly. John chapter 1, verse 1. Let me just show you something. John chapter 1, verse 1. In the beginning was the Word. You know it very well. And the Word, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was what? Was God. God and his word are the same. So how do you build a good friendship with God? Engage in his word. You cannot have a relationship with God and not have a relationship with his word. So it's going to be hard for you to be a friend of God and for you to experience God's friendship if you don't know his word, because God and his word are the same. Does that make sense? I just wanted to help those who sometimes struggle with seeing God as friend. We have no problem seeing him as God, powerful, mighty. Some of us might go as far as, well, he's like father, mother. But friend, we're talking about God here, Pastor. The enemy makes sure that we don't have the kind of relationship with God as we ought to. And one of the ways he does that is by causing there to be offenses and hurts and pain and issues of unforgiveness and issues of resentment in our lives. Oh, by the way, if God and his word are the same, if you're going to have a tight relationship with God, you need to belong to a church where his word is taught accurately. Just wanted to throw that in for good measure. So bitterness and unforgiveness will always rob us of a true friendship with God. And by that, I mean rob us of joy and enjoyment and peace and freedom. In other words, they will rob us of God's best for us. And I know we've been talking, and last week, you know, we literally had Holy Ghost surgery in this place last week. And some of what I'm talking about is not easy. It's difficult stuff. The experiences of hurt and offense and struggling and struggles and the unforgiveness. I mean, these are tough things, but those are things that we ought not to run from. Those are not things that we should ignore or feel bad about. We are humans, and humans get hurt oftentimes by other humans. And the biggest hindrance to spiritual blessings or any blessings are bitterness, resentment, and unforgiveness. I believe that with all my heart. Now, think about it. Just think of your own, those of you that have been in church, think of your own church experience. Oftentimes, preachers preach about everything but character. Oftentimes, we focus on the outside, but the inward issues like unforgiveness and bitterness and strife and gossip and backbiting, those things don't get talked about a lot. Let me give you guys some work to do in the back. Find me Proverbs 18:19. We'll preach and we'll end in a little while. But Proverbs 18:19. I will do my best to continue last week. But I want to show you how this is important. Proverbs 18:19. And then you know what? Prepare Matthew 6:15. Proverbs 18:19. I want to show you something, why this is important. An offended brother is harder to reach than a fortified city, and quarrels are like the bars of a fortress. Not an offended person. You can understand they're an unbeliever. An offended Christian. So no wonder why you can preach your heart out. You can pray for some people. They're harder to reach than a fortified city. So you getting the preaching, you hearing it, but the things of God are not having the effect that it's supposed to have in your life because you're all fortified up. What does Mark, Matthew, what is it, 6:15 say? We'll continue the point. Oh, good. But if you don't forgive people, your Father will absolutely forgive you. This is in the Bible. I just want to remind us fellow believers about some truth in the scriptures. If you don't forgive, it didn't say if you don't forgive some things. Because like I told you last week, this is very vulnerable for me. Because I try to be honest with you. I wish the Lord had said, there's some things I could understand if you don't forgive. Son, I'm with you. But he didn't say that. He says, if you don't forgive people, your Father will not forgive your wrongdoing. That is absolute hard stuff. I want you to hear my heart. Try Matthew chapter 5 and verse 24. I think this might help you. hopefully provoke you a little bit, and then I'll continue. Because this is important. When we speak blessings over our lives, how many of us receive it? All of us. All of us when we speak it. But are you like me where, have you reached that point? I know I can talk to you. Have you reached the point where you're like, okay, God, wait a minute here. You say tithe, I'm doing that. Give, go to, I'm doing, have you reached a point where you say, okay, God, wait a minute, something is missing? My latter is certainly not getting greater. That kind of mindset. Well, I want to show you something that might probably be the issue. Leave your gifts there in front of the altar. The idea is you go now to give your offering. Leave your gifts in front of the altar. First, go and be reconciled with your brother, and then come and offer your gift. Do we take this really seriously? Because you're rebuking the devil. I rebuke you, the devourer. God, you promised to open the windows of heaven. And I'm trying to say, you better make sure that whilst you're doing all of that, that there is not something in your heart that's hindering. Because the passage is clear. God is saying, I can't even bless your giving if you're harboring resentment and unforgiveness. If you are not in true, pure, healthy friendships. Godly friendships. I'm trying to help us so we can really be free. So the church can really be the church. We talked last week. Let me skip a few pages here. We talked last week about you have to admit that you hurt. And then you saw the preview, the recap. And like they told you, go online, catch the sermon. But the main point of number one was that you cannot forgive what is not acknowledged or admitted. And that's hard. And some of you, we've lived many, many years, and imagine all the stuff. Like, I hope you're working on your list. It's okay. Just write. Just keep writing. And you need help. We're available, willing to help you through that. Let me give you number two. If you're going to rid your heart of bitterness and unforgiveness, and you're going to experience the joy and the freedom, and you'll be blessed because of your giving and your serving and your loving, and you want to love properly, here's number two. Relinquish your right to justice. Now, I want you to understand, I believe this of the Lord. Don't mean to say I like it. So first you got to admit that you hurt. And then I have to relinquish, I'm just going to talk about myself, relinquish my right to justice. And I put the word punishment because sometimes I don't just want justice. I want you to burn. Nobody's ever done something and you love the scripture talks about heaping coals of fire and you get an image. Like I said, pray for me. I'm just talking to you. I mean, you know, family, it's just us. Don't tell anybody I have issues. But I'm being very honest with you. Like, even as Reverend Pastor Joel, sometimes I've had to, in my prayer time, say, God, I forgive that person, but don't get it twisted. I'm going to make them pay. Now, I haven't been able to do that. Thank the good Lord, because I tried and He stopped me. I didn't say I stopped myself. I just want you to get... this is hard. I mean, relinquish. Like, you wronged me. Relinquish your right. And of course, this is why I told you, you got to have a relationship with God through His Word. Because the problem is, you see, and I'm being honest with you, and I'm being as vulnerable as I can, and because when I struggle with it, because I've taken the word of God in my heart and I'm sincere about His Word and I genuinely love His Word, then His Word says, son, you need a washing. And then let's look at Romans chapter 12. Verse 17 to 19. Do not repay anyone evil for evil. I can confess to you that I've been in the Word long enough that when I'm dealing with certain situations and the Holy Spirit brings a scripture to my mind, I can tell what the scripture is going to talk about, and all of a sudden I get too busy to read it. I've had times where I would shift to worship or start praying with something else. Do not repay anyone evil for evil. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everyone. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Do not take revenge, my dear friends, but leave room for God's wrath. For it is written, it is mine to avenge. I will repay, says the Lord. Think about it. That's hard stuff. You may not, I don't know, but if you've lived for a while, you've experienced some stuff. Some folks have been in relationship and stuff has happened and you got plans and strategies. The worst part is when you got no house on how to get justice. Like, you know that if I do this and I have access to this computer and if I talk to that person, I can mess your credit up for life. Police pull you over all the time. You have no idea why. But here's the problem. Stuff happens in relationships, and we stay in the relationship without consciously giving up our right for justice. And the problem, to have justice, and the problem is there is no trust then in that relationship. And that relationship becomes dysfunctional. And you're praying for it to get better, and you're hoping for it to get better. It's just because you're still hoping to get some justice. You know, some people say they forgive, but they actually still hold on to the situation for leverage. For control. And true forgiveness requires that you must give up your right to justice, give up your right to punishment, give up your right to revenge. Because if not, things will be imbalanced. Somebody will always be in control, and someone will always be controlled. True forgiveness requires that you relinquish your right to justice and to punishment. Now, let me say something. Giving up your right to justice does not mean that you are letting the person off the hook. Relinquishing your right to justice and punishment does not mean that you are letting the person off the hook. When you give up your right to justice, you're simply saying, God, I'm giving it all to you. I'm not going to be the one to give punishment. You are the one that will punish. I will let you be the judge. I will let you be the jury. I will let you be the executioner. I leave it up to you. Very important to understand that, because if not, you will not effectively do it. I feel like I need to address the issue of forgiveness. This won't be on your screen, but I feel like I need to address the issue of forgiveness. What is forgiveness? What is forgiveness? In simple terms, forgiveness is choosing to be free. Simply put, forgiveness is choosing to be free. In other words, forgiveness is choosing to free up your hands today so you can possess your tomorrow. Forgiveness is all about freedom. Let me tell you what forgiveness is not. Forgiveness is not justifying the actions or the choices of others. Forgiveness is not letting people off the hook. It's not justifying the choices or the actions of others. It's not letting people off the hook. Forgiveness is also not, forgiveness does not mean accepting reconciliation. Are you with me? Forgiveness does not mean I forgive you, therefore then we have to reconcile. No way, Jose. Forgiveness does not mean that I'm going to stay in relationship with you. And this does not just mean romantic relationships. Okay? Friendships as well. This is important. So me forgiving someone is not me saying that it's okay that they left. Or it's okay that they lied. Or it's okay that they hurt me. And forgiveness does not guarantee that a person will always be a part of your life. Forgiveness is about choosing freedom, choosing to allow healing, choosing to allow wisdom to enter in so that I will not allow in the future what I allowed back then. This is important. Let me quickly go to number three. Point number three. Choose to pray for the offender. It gets worse. I'm hoping there's at least three people that's not judging me that can actually understand what it's like. Because first, you got to admit that you're wrong. Secondly, you got to relinquish your right. And now, he says, you got to pray for the offender. Can I be honest with you? This is hard. Because there is praying, and there is praying. So I, you know, you want me to pray for them? Sure. God, well, I know that you're a God of justice. And you do not desire that your children should suffer at the hands of the wicked. But you do desire to give grace to the wicked. So, teach them a lesson as you show them how, you get what I'm saying? How to repent. I mean, that's a prayer. Man, I feel so alone right now. I feel so vulnerable. Nobody's had that kind of, you cannot be accused of not praying. I did, and as a matter of fact, ooh, and you feel so good. And then it's all right, as long as I have my Lord. Like, you're good. I mean, nobody's ever prayed, God, give me the power to control lightning. Give them COVID 7 times, Lord, so that they would have time alone, so that they can learn to encounter you and be changed. No. That's not the kind of prayer that you get to pray. Matthew chapter 5, verse 43 to 44. I hope you, what I'm trying to say is that this is beneficial, but I want you to understand it's not easy. And I think sometimes as Christians, I'm trying to be vulnerable and frank because we really didn't know how to properly do it. That's why we're still stuck. And never have what we're supposed to have. Instead of coming from that point of honesty, God, you say to pray. And so I will pray, but I want you to understand, here is my heart. Here's what is in my heart. And so God, you change my heart and teach me how to pray for such and such. So here's what he says. Matthew 5, and this is important. You have heard the law that says, love your neighbor. I mean, there's just some things in the scriptures that you just like, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say, love your enemies. Pray for those who persecute you. I mean, if these things, when you read these things in scriptures, if you get all spiritual about it, yeah, I'm not sure we can actually get along for a long time. Well, now we can. But there was a time when this would bother me. Because what kind of God? You don't know what I've been through. You want me to love? You want me to pray? You want me to love my enemies? And pray for those who persecute me. And in some cases, they're still persecuting me. Let me be further honest. I've had times where I've had to pray for folks. I can't even say their name. God, you know all people. And you created. So yes, Lord, you know. My favorite used to be, your will be done in their lives. It sounds good, but it was not pure. But here's what I've come to learn. Now, I'm showing you that I was messed up, but I hope you get in the other part. Huh? Don't be like, well, if pastor struck, I'm trying to show you the other side. I'm growing. Just get this part too. Because here's what I've learned. Praying for those who hurt me is helpful. Why? Because it takes a lot of emotional strength and anxiety for me to live with bitterness and resentment and a hard heart. And so what I have learned is when I learn to pray for my offenders and learn to pray that God will truly bless them and lead them to true repentance, and when I pray that God will take them higher and give them grace, the same grace that I need. Here's what I've noticed. Every time I pray for them, where my heart was once hard, it's like soil. And so what happens when I pray for them is like the soil of my heart gets tilled one layer at a time. The more I pray, one layer at a time, one layer at a time. And each time I pray, my heart gets softer and softer. And pretty soon, here's what happens. The word of God of promises and healing and peace and freedom and joy for my life can actually now find good soil to produce fruit. And so God begins to produce something beautiful where there was unhappiness, where there was misery, where there was sadness. I hope you understand that I'm saying to us that God can set us free. And God does want to set us free. God does not want our past to be in our present. But we have to admit we're hurt. We have to choose to relinquish our right to justice. And we have to learn to pray for our offenders. Let me see if I can give you one or two more. Let's keep going. Be willing but wise about reconciliation. I want to be balanced in our teaching. Be willing, but wise about reconciliation. Again, this is tough because there are times when I think God, he's not, but there are times when I think he's being unfair. Because some things have really hurt. Some things have serious consequences. And sometimes God does say, reconcile. But it must be wise. Because here's what happens. Some people forgive and never seek reconciliation. Then they come to service like this and they feel guilty when they hear heart message. After all, you were hurt. And now you feel guilty about, or you feel some measure of shame about the situation where you were wronged. Because you're thinking, well, I guess I should be open to being reconciled, because you know the pastor talks about brotherly love and we should all love each other, but I was wronged. And then you have other people who forgive and they reconcile. So you got those who forgive and never seek reconciliation. You got those who forgive and reconcile even though there is no evidence of change. But they think forgiveness is letting the person back in, so they forgive, they let them back in, then they become resentful towards God. Because God says forgive, and because they think forgiveness is letting them back in, and they become resentful towards God, because guess what? The person had not changed. So look at Romans chapter 12, verse 18. Do all that you can to live in peace with everyone. Do all that you can to live in peace with everyone. This clearly implies that you may not be able to live in peace with everybody. But do all that you can. And there comes a point where you may have to say, that I cannot do. Listen, forgiveness and fellowship are not the same thing. I forgive you. We are having tea together. I forgive you. I understand that it's freezing cold. Here's $10. Take a cab. I forgive you. Don't call the phone. No more, no more. Am I making sense? Forgiveness, I have to do. Fellowship? Mm-mm. Conditions? We're so free sometimes. And Christians, we misinterpret things. And then you blame God. And God's like, sweetie, me and my word are one. If you spend time in my word, you'll understand. As a matter of fact, if you went to a good church where they teach the word accurately, I hear Shiloh is taking members, you would understand things properly. Because forgiveness and reconciliation. Now, please, let me say this. Now, don't go out there and be like, well, I'm going, yep, I'm so hurt, I'm not going to reconcile. Remember what the point says. Okay, I mean, I just like to give balance because some of us, you just want to put the work into it. It's just going to lean more to, it looks too hard to reconcile. Be willing and wise, okay? Just want to make sure you have it. Here, let me give you some points. Most of you know I love practical, methodical approach to things. Now, these just some points. It's not on the screen. I'm just going to tell you how to judge if reconciliation is possible. There must be sincere repentance. I didn't say they stopped doing what they did. I'm going to preach on this in a couple of weeks. Repentance is not doing what you did. Repentance is changing your mind about what you were doing. So look for sincere repentance because their behavior could be dormant until the right moment presents itself. So look for sincere repentance, a heart change. What are their words? What are their actions? By the way, that requires time. So don't be so lonely that, well, I give you 3 weeks and then you choose to fast for 3 days and you say, Lord, I'm fasting. Should I reconcile or not? And then 3 days up and you heard nothing from the Lord and you're like, well, must be that I must reconcile. Look for sincere repentance. Look for evidence of change. If you want there to be fellowship, there must be sincere repentance. There must be evidence of change. And in addition to that, trust must be being earned. Why do we feel like people have, if you've lost my trust, you've got to earn it? Well, you keep talking about what I did wrong because I was hurt. But if you were sincere, now I'm not talking about people who just, you know, some people just love it. You can tell when it's of the devil and when it's a trust issue. You know, people keep reminding you of your past. I'm not talking about that. If a person is sincerely struggling and that relationship matters, earn the trust. Trust must be earned, and also not just trust, but honor must be given. By the way, that's a good quality for friendships, honoring each other. That means that when you call, I take the call or I call back. We talk about stuff. I honor you. And there must be respect being given and earned. If there's going to be fellowship, there must be respect, there must be honor, there must be trust, there must be evidence of change, and there must be sincere repentance. True repentance is not saying, have you ever had that somebody offended you and they use words like, I'm sorry that you did not understand what I was saying. Or here's the phrase, I'm sorry that that hurt you. By the way, all that means when you say that to someone, all you're saying is, I'm sorry that you're not emotionally mature enough to handle what happened. Joseph's brother sincerely repented. No excuses. You want to know what a true apology is? I am sorry. I was wrong. Please forgive me. The person keeps bringing it up. I am sorry. I was wrong. Please forgive me. Never feel guilty about putting boundaries if the things necessary for reconciliation are not present. There are times when reconciliation is possible, but there are times when it's just not possible. Be willing, but be wise. Let me support this biblically. 2 Timothy chapter 2. 2 Timothy chapter 2. Again, I say, don't get involved in foolish, ignorant arguments that only start fights. A servant of the Lord must not quarrel. I wish every Christian would pay attention to what the Bible says. Have you been watching the news and you see Christian for quarreling with other people? A servant of the Lord must not quarrel, but must be kind to everyone. Pro-vaxxers, anti-vaxxers, kind to everyone. Liberal, kind to everyone. Same race, different race, kind to everyone. Be able to teach and be patient. Again, lump in my throat with difficult people. That means there's going to be difficult people in my life. Don't pray them away. God planned them there for a purpose. He's just, you know, sometimes people are like God sandpaper. Just trying to smooth you out. But here's what it says. Gently instruct those who oppose the truth. Perhaps God will change those people's hearts and they will learn the truth. So sometimes I've had to wait a couple hours before I tell you that you hurt me. You know why? Because that's the only time I can do it gently. It says, do it gently. So, if I were to tell you right now, I'm not trying to necessarily be comical. I'm trying to be relatable. Because there are times when stuff happens, like my folks where I grew up would say, boy, if I only tell you what is on my mind, you see. Do you understand? If you don't understand it. But you get what I'm saying? Sometimes you can't say what's on your mind. And by the way, even the Bible supports the three-strike rule. Titus chapter 3, verse 9 to 11. Continues almost the same concept. Do not get involved in foolish discussions about spiritual pedigrees or in quarrels and fights about obedience to Jewish laws. These things are useless and a waste of time. If people are causing division among you, give a first and second warning. Strike one, strike two. After that, have nothing to do with them. Strike three, you're out. be reconciled. Now, please don't be running towards like, oh, I'm just going to set you up for you to get to strike three because then I can live in peace, because it's not what I'm advocating. I just want to be clear. Okay? And I get that reconciliation, always be willing to reconcile, but be wise. And let me say something. Reconciliation will be hard when you're dealing with addictive behaviors. Reconciliation will be hard when you're dealing with mental struggles. Reconciliation will be hard when you're dealing with abuse. By the way, nobody should ever endure any form of abuse, verbal, physical. You do not deserve that. Under no circumstances. I believe it's an affront to God to allow yourself to be taken advantage of. And I know that that happens. But I just want to remind you, nobody should talk to you any kind of how, do any sort of thing to you. You know how valuable you are. So we may not always be able to have the fellowship, but we must always have forgiveness. Let me give you number five. And I promise you we'll wrap it up and we'll be done. Ask God for strength and healing and freedom. This is an obvious one, correct? Because it's the only way that we can really do it. Ask God for strength, healing, and freedom. Because as you can see, 1, 2, 3, and 4 is hard. It's difficult, but you got to get God involved in the process. Jesus knows this will be hard. That's why he says, pray this every day. Forgive me as I forgive those who have wronged me. In other words, forgive me as I work on those and be working on it who have wronged me. So, what are you going to do with this 2 weeks of teachings? Because I think all of us can relate to this. If I were to say, somebody says, Pastor, who's this message for? This message is for people who are having seasons of spiritual dryness. This message is for people who are feeling stuck, stalled. People who feel like there's a wall between them and God. People who are often fearful. People who feel imprisoned. People who have anger towards God. Or anger, period. People who have little or no sensitivity to the Holy Spirit. This message is for people who are avoiding God. People who are running from God. People who have often frequent bursts of anger. This message is also for people who are frequently ill. Here's what I mean. Some kind of sicknesses like high blood pressure, depression, heart issues, anxiety, muscle issues, joint pains, oftentimes is connected to issues of unforgiveness and bitterness and resentment. People who struggle with self-hatred. This message is for them. People who are self-righteous and who feel entitled. People who exercise poor judgment often. This message is for people who have that mindset, I will never trust anybody. I will never confide in anybody. I'm saying to us that sometimes we need to forgive ourselves. Sometimes the person who needs forgiveness is you. Sometimes the person who needs forgiveness may be dead. Because they left you, they did something to you and they died. Sometimes some people need to forgive God. You know, I think it's okay to feel disappointed by God, as long as you're honest with Him about it. Some people are just angry at God because their life didn't turn out the way they thought it should. Imagine you belong to a particular church or you listen to a particular preaching, teaching, and you didn't learn some things and you did some things and it didn't turn out the way. Take, for example, finances. Can I tell you something? The church has taught finances in a wrong way that most people now are like, I'm not giving church my money. Because number one, they taught you that you're actually giving church your money. That's a problem in and of itself. Because when you're tithing and you're giving, it's not about the church. The church just happens to be, and by the way, that does not excuse church responsibility on proper financial management. But I'm saying tithing and giving is about your relationship with God, your obedience to God. Some people have been taught wrong, that they figured, I'm not going to make the things of God a priority. The people of God don't make me a priority. So therefore, then I'll take care of myself and what's left over I'll give to the church. Am I making sense? There are times when we're taught wrong things, and so, but we're given false expectations. How many times have you heard, give and it'll be given to you, good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over, shall men give into your bosom? A few passages right before that, it talks about bitterness, resentment, and all those stuff. That too is a part of it, not just the money. I've said it last week, and I'll say it again. Sometimes you need to forgive an institution. Sometimes you need to forgive an object, you know. It could be a car that you got that couldn't pay for, ended up bankrupt, the house. I don't know. You know, these are things for you to think about. These types of teachings are important because unforgiveness affects our soul. It affects our spirit. It hinders our spiritual growth. It hinders our fruitfulness. It hurts our relationship, and it hurts our health. Let's close with a few passages of scripture. We'll run through them real quick. 2 Corinthians 13. Dear brothers and sisters, I close my letter with these last words. Be joyful. Grow to maturity. Encourage each other. Live in harmony and peace. That's what God desires. But we will not be able to live up to that if we harbor unforgiveness. 2 Corinthians 12:9. My grace is enough for you. When you are weak, my power is made perfect in you. I'm very happy to brag about my weakness. Then Christ's power can live in me. Sometimes as you try to live out this message, you'll have to say, God, I don't have the strength to face it. I don't have the strength to feel what's hurting me. God, I actually want justice. God, I don't want to pray for anybody, especially my offenders. But here's what God says, let me in. Because when you're at your weakest, I'm at my strongest. Matthew 19:26. Jesus looked at them and said, with man, this is impossible, but with God, all things are possible. What am I saying? It's going to be difficult, but God can get us through. When we don't think we can get through some stuff, let him in. He's got us. Because with him, all things are possible. And finally, Philippians 2:9. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth. What am I saying? There is always power in the name of Jesus. And strongholds of unforgiveness and strongholds of bitterness and resentment will always fall at the name of Jesus, because at the name of Jesus, the impossible becomes possible. Let's stand. Last week, we closed with a bang. Folks were here until 3 o'clock in the afternoon last week. Don't worry. But here's what I want to say. I think for most of us, this message is about us engaging in a process. Some of us needed that immediate surgery last week. But some need to continue this process. I believe that for some people, the marriage you want is connected to your obedience to this message. For some people, your success, your prosperity, even as a parent, your success in life is connected to your response to this message. So yes, I admit that this is painful, what we're asking you to do. But walking into your dreams is worth the process. I think it's really time to start putting some things in the past and letting them stay there. So here's where I want us to close. We are going to put a prayer on the screen. And some of you may not be ready to pray it. But we're going to put it on the screen. And then I want you to take a moment and read it. And decide if you're ready to pray it. And some of you may have to pray it several times. Because there's a part where you got to put in some names. And when we come to that part, we'll stop for a little bit. But this may just be the beginning of the process. Put the prayer on for me. I want you to take a moment and just read it. And then we'll pray together. If you're ready to pray. You good? Okay, not yet. How about now? Everybody's read through? Now, I admit, some people may not be ready to pray this. Or you may be ready to just pray, you know, just one person for today. A part of it. But I really believe that we need to engage in this process. So we're going to sing, "Change My Heart, O God." And then we'll pray this prayer. Those of us that are willing and ready to do that. It's going to be tough. But we'll sing that. And I don't want you to feel alone. When we sing the song and we give the benediction, Reverend Lorraine and will head upstairs and she'll be available. If somebody wants prayer, please don't leave without getting prayed for. Sister Halcyon will join her as well. In case, you know, you just want to talk to somebody, you just want further prayer. It could be about what we've preached about or anything. Please don't leave without receiving prayer. But let's ask the Lord to change our hearts. Time is already gone, but I think this could be a God moment.
Change my heart, oh God.
Make it ever true.
Make it ever true.
Change my heart, oh God.
Change my heart, oh God. May I be like you.
Change my heart, oh God.
Change my heart, oh God. Make it ever true. Change my heart, oh God. May I be like you.
The potter.
You are the potter.
I am the clay.
I am the clay.
Mold me and make me.
Mold me and make me.
This is
what I play. Change my heart, oh God. Make it ever true. Change my heart, oh God. May I be like you.
If we are ready, those of us that are. And again, if you're struggling, you're not ready, that's all right. Take a shot, get online, send me an email for a copy of it, whatever. But let's those, I think some of us are ready to pray this now. Ready to start this process of healing. God, I want a better life. I want a better marriage. I want everything that you have in store for me. I no longer want any blockages. Let's pray. God, I choose to admit that my today is affected by hurts from my yesterday. Forgive me for not forgiving those who have hurt me. Today, I choose to rid my heart and my life of unforgiveness. Pause. I'm just going to repeat it. Today, I choose to rid my heart and my life of unforgiveness. Breathe. Continue. And I choose to let go of hurt and anger. Pause. I choose to let go of hurt and anger. Father, help this to be truly true for someone, truly sincere. Continue. In Jesus' name, I choose to completely forgive. You may say the name, bring their pictures to mind. even those painful memories, Lord. Painful words, discouraging words. Could be somebody's own children, somebody's own spouse, Lord. Give them grace to release them now. Themselves. Father, somebody needs to say to you, I choose to forgive you that you caused me to lose that baby, or at least I think you did. I choose to forgive you because I thought I'd been married by now, but you keep blocking me. I choose to forgive you because I feel like you're preventing things from just working out, no matter how hard I try. I choose to forgive you, God, because I just have a hard time getting over myself, and I keep asking you for help, and I don't feel like you're helping. Choose to forgive a parent. Choose to forgive a boss. I choose to forgive my dad, who was never really there. I choose to forgive that person in the church, or that pastor who bothered me, who hurt me, who offended me, who disappointed me, who took advantage of me. Let's continue. God, heal me from all the wounds that have been inflicted. Make me whole and set me free. I admit my hurts. I relinquish my right to justice. I ask you to bless my offenders. Pause. Yep, Lord. Bless, that's what I mean. Mm-hmm. Bless them. Yep, truly bless them. And help me to be okay with it. Truly bless them. And help me to rejoice with them. Truly bless them. Help me to wish them well. We continue. Make me willing and wise about reconciliation. And I ask you for your strength, your freedom, and your healing. In Jesus' name. Amen. Can I say something? I'm way over time, but none of you who are here today, no person listening to this, there is no accidents with God. So whilst we're way over time, and I'm very much aware of that, but I believe that God, is doing something in hearts. Because I believe with all my heart that God has things that he wants to take us into, and he's preparing us. And this message is a challenge. I'm not self-promoting, but I'm encouraging you, get this message. However, listen to it. Let the word do its work. Some people have been hanging on to things for 20, 30 years, and God's like, I want to honor the prayer. I want to honor the prophecies that has been spoken over your life, but you are tying my hands. I need you to admit that you were hurt. I need you to leave justice up to me, and I need you to sincerely learn to pray for them. Would you ask me for strength? Would you ask me to heal you? As a matter of fact, oh, thank you, Holy Spirit. Some folks, you actually have admitted you're wrong. You actually do genuinely pray, but you're lacking the healing. The healing. God, heal some wounded, broken heart today. God, there is some woman who needs her heart healed. God, there is a man who needs his heart healed. There is a woman who is just so broken, and she keeps self-hurting and afflicting herself by constantly beating up on herself and inflicting shame and guilt upon herself. There is some man struggling with regret. God, in Jesus' name, give them an encounter in this moment. Father, somebody needs to release their parents. And I pray that you would teach them that the only perfect parent that there is God Almighty. You are the perfect father. You are the perfect mother. So God, whilst you may have chosen and used earthly vessels to bring us into existence, Father, bring us to that point where we will trust you as the ultimate parent and release our human parents. Honor our human parents for what they've done. And at times, as imperfect as it may be, God, I pray, true healing will happen in this place for those who will linger, those who has to leave, but true healing and true freedom. Father, in Jesus' name, as even as we sang the song, No More Bondage earlier, I pray that you would break every chain. I pray that you'd bring down walls. I pray that you'll set some people free and you'll release them from all bondage. God, I see generational bondages and emotional bondages and spiritual bondages and relational bondages being released of people in the name of Jesus Christ. God, I pray that you will cause us to breathe again fresh air. Cause us to see the light, so to speak, to experience true freedom. Give us a new vision, a new perspective. Give us new hope. Give us a new vision of the future that you have for us. God, I pray that we who are here, that we would hear your heartbeat, God, for each one of us. In Jesus' name, I'm so grateful that you are here and that you've taken the time. And I just sense the Holy Spirit doing something. So as I said, if you need prayer, I know of these two ladies, Reverend Lorraine and Sister Halcyon, are two people who, and I think there's some things in the Christian realm that involves impartation. You pray through, but these are two women that I know, at the risk of, if I would, I guess, exercise pastoral privileges, these are two women who walk these things out. And so who would understand? Because I say this because there's a sensitivity about all of this. But don't carry the stuff anymore. So they'll be upstairs in one of the rooms, and just please, if you need prayer for whatever reason and you may not be ready, you want to give us a call during the week, that's fine. But please don't hang on to these things anymore. Let the Lord do the work. Let him take you into all that he has for you. Like I said, I see marriages and I see stuff connected to this healing. You know, I've always believed, don't get married if you're not emotionally healthy. Don't marry folks that are not emotionally healthy. You're just going to have a whole lot of issues unnecessarily. I'll give you the blessing. The service is dismissed after the blessing. Feel free to leave, Sister Nat, and the deacons will be at the door to greet you. I'm so happy that you're here. And we'll sing Create in Me a Clean Heart, O God, after the message as the people leave. So, beloved, receive the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. For the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. And that peace from God that passes all understanding will keep your hearts and your minds in the knowledge and the love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, who is our Lord. And, beloved, every blessing of God Almighty, who is Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be upon you and with you, both now and forever. If you receive it in Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. If you were blessed by today's service, would you give the Lord a hand clap of praise? This is tough stuff, but we're going to continue. Maybe we may have to do some of these in teachings. But God is doing something. So these guys will stay here. They'll sing. If you need a moment in the sanctuary, feel free to stay. Do that. Those of you that have to leave, let's continue to maintain, of course, physical distancing and in this fourth wave season. And Father, even as we partook of the Holy Communion, but I one more time plead the blood covering over us, Lord. You will keep us. You will keep this COVID issue from us. You will protect us even as the fourth wave is all around. Keep us safe, God. And not only us, but those that are dear to us. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. God bless you. Have a wonderful week.